Coding with Dee released a video that ends with her calling no code a trap. Strong words. As a developer who's been working with non-tech clients for 8 years, I disagree. Let's get to the video. I didn't want to go in blind. I've already watched the video. I'll be pausing here and there to agree, disagree, and add any extra takeaways that I can think of. And maybe a few stupid jokes. Let's go.
No code app development is a trap. I fell into this trap and lost a lot of money. So this is my story. One day I had an idea. I know, real me to have an idea. But I thought, hang on, this idea would make a great app. I didn't know how to build mobile apps. I haven't done it at that stage, but I did know how to code, just not mobile apps. And I did some research and I figured I should just do no code. It was 2023 at that stage. And I thought, hey, the technology must be out there. And to be honest, I just didn't want to learn a new programming language.
Okay, so from what she said so far, it sounds like she's some sort of a web-based developer. So she knows how to code, but doesn't specialize in mobile development. That's why real pros do cross-platform, baby. I'm joking. I think it's important because this puts Dee above the typical no-code user, who is someone with zero coding skills and usually minimal to zero experience in app development. I'll try not to pause so quickly. Let's keep going.
And Flutterflow is a no-code app development platform. It is probably one of the most popular no-code platforms out there. And on Flutterflow, you can actually build iOS and Android apps without using code. The backend of Flutterflow is actually the language Flutter. But the idea here is that you will not be programming. You won't be actually coding in Flutter. It's more of a drag and drop platform that you can start building apps. And so I began to build my app. And I think I started the process correctly. I looked at their documentation. I watched a bunch of YouTube tutorials. I created the wireframe on Balsamiq. I would say I was around 20 to 30% complete when things just started not looking right. I wanted to do specific things on my app, which I thought was reasonably easy, but I just couldn't do it.
Yep, I think that's how you do it. She doesn't mention it explicitly, but it sounds like she did a round of requirements gathering, which is always super important. But what she described there as a sudden problem is part of using any tool. The problem is either you, meaning you are still unfamiliar with how to use the tool, or it's the tool itself. It's just the limit of the tool, and it can't go any further than that. The first one is a pain in the ass, but you can fix it by learning. And the second one just sucks balls.
And because it wasn't a default feature, I thought, hang on, I know with Flutterflow, if you want that uniqueness, that ability to customize things, you can create a custom widget. But I couldn't do that because it actually didn't work. So I reached a roadblock and I could not continue. So then I thought, I'm having so many issues. Surely it's not me. And I was right. It is not only me.
Yep. Feels good to know others share your pain.
5 months ago, there was a post on Reddit under the Flutter Dev subreddit. And it said, Flutterflow raised 25.5 million. Anyway, that post actually wasn't the interesting part. The interesting part was the comment below it. Now, it is quite a long comment, but it summarized my issues that I was having with Flutterflow. I was quite active in the Flutterflow environment for about a year and a half. At the time, I was very happy with it, to be honest. I would say I was in the 10 to 90% project completion phase of my app.
Imagine if an AppStack Studio client asked me for a project update and I told them, between 10 to 90% done. I don't know. It's just funny to think about it. Sorry.
However, when I got to the last 10%, I realized that Flutterflow is a 90% completion product. They go on to say, in my experience, when I hit the 90% and started seeing the cracks, I thought, oh well, that sucks. Luckily, I can add a custom widget. So I started there. And wow, adding custom widgets and trying to integrate them into the Flutterflow code base without any sort of error logging was awful. After this, I thought, well, I might as well find a dev to help. I then hire Bluecry to help with one of their custom packages, and they couldn't figure it out either. Finally, I thought, that sucks.
More like Blue Sky sucks, am I right? Just kidding, shout out to Blue Sky.
I guess I have hit the limit of Flutterflow. I need to download the code. So in Flutterflow, you do have the option of downloading your code base and getting the physical code, after you develop your app. So I did, and dear Lord, that code base was awful.
This is interesting. It challenges my perception of Flutterflow and no-code as a whole. Yes, Flutterflow offers code export, as opposed to a platform like Bubble, which doesn't. And the idea is if my app outgrows Flutterflow, I just download the code and hire a developer or a Flutter developer to work on it. With Bubble, your code is stuck there. And I've always taken code export as a clear advantage when choosing a no-code platform. I never actually stopped to ask, how good is the exported code? If it's so bad that human developers can't work with it, wouldn't it be the same thing? In which case, it doesn't matter and becomes mostly misleading. Let's keep watching.
It was straight up horrible. Spaghetti was an understatement. So then I thought, well, I need someone with more experience because this is getting out of control. So I hired a dev. They took one look and tried and then said, we can rebuild it in 2 weeks. And so we did. We are finally in a good place by Flutterflow just about sank our startup. And what this person has experienced and what many people have experienced with Flutterflow was the same thing that I experienced. When I downloaded my Flutterflow code, it was terrible. And I don't even code in Flutter, but I realized it was terrible. There were so many errors, and I could tell because at this stage, I started to actually learn Flutter to understand my Flutterflow code. And it just looked wrong. And it's not only Flutter that has these issues.
I've never actually downloaded source code from one of these platforms. So if this experience is the typical code export experience from Flutterflow, that's a problem. Doesn't stop Flutterflow from being one of the good no-code app builder. It just removes one of its key advantages.
People also posted similar issues with another very popular no-code platform called Bubble.
Bubble. I agree with everything she says here. Gonna skip this part and play my shameless pitch instead. My team and I at Upside Studio help non-technical entrepreneurs grow past $5 to $10 million in annual revenue with custom software. We've worked with over 30 leading brands across industries. These businesses were stuck where no ready-made solution on the market solved their problem. To continue growing, they had to make their own solution. If your business is also currently stuck at this $5 to $10 million level and you want to explore custom solutions, let me help. There's a link in the description to sign up for a free, no strings attached strategy session. We'll dissect your current constraint together and you get an honest opinion about whether custom software is your answer. And if yes, we decide if we can work together. If it's not, you just save yourself from a very big investment with no ROI. Apply through the link and we'll be in touch. I'm only taking 3 of these calls per month and it's first come, first serve. So if you want to work with me, apply now. Back to the video.
Now at this stage, you might be asking, fine, there's issues with these no-code app development platforms, but why is it a trap? And I get it. I know that every platform does have its pros and cons. And yes, you can still build functional apps with Flutterflow and Bubble and other no-code platforms. But the reason why I think it is a trap is twofold. The first fold is that most of the no-code clients don't know how to code, as in haven't ever developed even one line of code. So coming in, the clients don't really have an idea of everything that is involved when you create some sort of app. Because I was experienced in coding, I could tell pretty early on that there were specific things I couldn't do, and that was a red flag to me. But I can picture someone maybe not knowing how to code, buying a platform like Bubble or Flutterflow, developing until 90%, spending a lot of time and hours, and then just can't actually complete it because of the restrictions.
I think she's right that the typical users of a no-code app builder doesn't know how to code. And for that reason, they won't really know the limitation of a no-code platform. And unlike someone like her or me, because we can code, we don't need a no-code app builder, and they are more likely to limit us from building the way we think is best. But that's like criticizing water for being wet. I know water's not actually wet, but you get the idea. No-code app builders aren't meant for people like Dee and myself. They are meant for the Homer Simpsons who don't know how to code. And yeah, it's a painful experience to build to 90% and get stuck. But if 90% is good enough for an MVP that can get user validation, that's fantastic. And I want to be pragmatic here. So let's revisit that 90% and get stuck situation. If you can't code and don't want to code, you have two choices: no code app builders or hire a developer. And a bad experience with a developer is going to cost you way more than a bad experience with no code subscription. It's a huge price difference. It's so big that you might as well see if no code can get you there, because if it can, you have just saved a shit ton of money. And there are so many success stories of no code MVPs and even full-fledged no code apps and SaaS that you can't really tell what your experience will be like before you try. And I think it's a risk worth taking, unless you are already a millionaire or have 3 months left to live. So I disagree there. Let's hear the second reason.
The sixth issue is that you can't actually build good, unique apps with these no-code platforms. And this is the common issue. The main complaint for any no-code platforms is that you can't customize it. So either you develop a very run-of-the-mill common app, or you don't build anything at all. And this would be fine. It actually would be perfectly fine if the no-code platforms were a bit more honest with it. They just aren't. In their marketing materials, in their demo videos, they phrase things differently. If you look at these no-code development platforms, look at their websites, you always get the sense that, wow, this no-code development platform can do it all. This is Bubble's front page. The world's only full-stack no-code platform. Design, develop, and launch production-grade applications without code. It doesn't matter if you're starting out or you are an enterprise team, Bubble is for anyone. Here is Flutterflow. Build applications faster than ever. Create beautiful UI, generate clean code, deploy the app to the App Store or web in one click, fully extensible with custom code. I've used Flutterflow. That is the furthest definition of Flutterflow there is. When I downloaded that code base, it was terrible. I would have never been able to deploy my app on Flutterflow unless I probably got an experienced Flutter dev to go and fix that messy code, sort out the errors, and then only I would have probably deployed it. Because obviously if there's errors in your code, the iOS store would immediately reject it. And it really is okay if these no-code platforms market themselves as a platform that gets you the minimum viable product quickly. So if you want to show clients a quick MVP or a proof of concept, go ahead and use something like Bubble and Flutterflow. It's great. We'll do that for you. But if you want a full grade production ready app, you have to do it the old fashioned way.
This one I fully agree with. I think a lot of no-code app builders overstate their abilities. But that's the nature of marketing, you know. If you guys own businesses and you've launched software products, your landing page and your backend aren't always going to be the same. If SaaS landing pages were honest, they would all say something like this: the software is kind of shit right now, but give us a few weeks to handle it. In the meantime, please subscribe to our premium lifetime plan. Stuff like this just won't sell. Or maybe it will. You want to take a risk? And it doesn't help that a lot of big tech companies, including no-code app builders, have marketing teams without tech people. So they don't really understand the product. I've dealt with a few and it's always frustrating. Some of them really believe their app builder is God's gift to mankind. And I'm trying not to tell them what I think about the app, a bit like this. So out of these 2 points for no-code being a trap, I agree that it's often marketed to do way more than it can, which can be frustrating for developers who know they're not that good. But when we say it, potential clients won't trust us because we have a financial stick. Let's see how D ends it.
So why are they marketing it like this? And when you do speak to any developer who has worked on these tools, if you speak to web developers, if you speak to mobile app developers, they actually tell you the same thing. They tell you that if you want to use a product like Flutterflow or Bubble or any other no-code tool, it's good for something simple, something quick. It's terrible with customization. It's terrible with scalability. Do it the old-fashioned way. So if you are thinking about no-code, which is fine, I think first do your research. But second, also understand that no-code app development platforms will always be second best to actually just sitting down and coding or paying an experienced developer to create your mobile app.
In summary, this is no-code is okay, but do your research and understand no-code is inferior to custom code. I'm in complete agreement about point number one. Different no-code app builders have different learning curves, and Bubble and Flutterflow are among the most powerful no-code app builders out there right now. The more powerful the tool, the harder it is to learn and master. And if you don't have to, why would you? So if you're new to no-code, I recommend going to the no-code subreddit and ask if your idea can be built with a specific no-code tool. Just remember, the more specific you are about your idea, the better responses you will get. And definitely do not leave a comment under YouTube videos asking for help. It gets buried. As for Dee's second point, I half agree. She says no-code is inferior to custom code. I would phrase it as no-code is inferior to properly done custom code. It sounds like Uncle Adrian is just being fussy. And you know what? Fussy is my middle name. Dee said it would be better to just learn how to code. And I cannot agree with that. Most of the time, that results in a far worse product than a no-code app builder. Learning to code to build an app is like becoming an English teacher to improve your English. You need to have decent English before you teach or your students will suffer. You need to have decent coding skills before you can build something or the product suffers. And as for sitting down with a developer, you could end up hiring a shit developer too. Some of them overpromise as much as these app builders, while writing worse code and charging you way more. So while I feel for these experience, I think we can agree that she would have lost a lot more if it had been custom code and a full development team. Between no code and custom code, no code carries much lower risk. And unless you have tens of thousands you are prepared to burn, go no code. I had fun making this video, so if you guys had fun watching, I wouldn't mind doing more reaction videos. Recommend some stuff for me to react to and judge. Meanwhile, if you're on the hunt for a no-code app builder, check out my app builder tier list.